You found a place to belong here in the Circle of Friends. I'm Missy, and I'm with my friends, Libby, my new friend, Ellie. I'm so delighted. Welcome back.
Oh, it's so good to be here. And yes, Ellie, welcome back. We'll take you any day we can get you.
Thank you.
Yeah. You know, we've been really focusing on kind of how your life has been and your story. And as I told you before we came on air, I don't want you to keep talking about stuff if you're done, but I think Missy and I just want to keep hearing you talk about things. You know, and one thing you had mentioned off the air earlier in the week was scripture from Hosea.
Yes.
And I totally then forgot about it until seriously right now. And I'm wondering, can we go back to how you came upon that scripture passage and what that means to you?
Yeah, so I stumbled upon this scripture during a really hard summer of my life. It was the summer of 2016. And when I read this scripture in my devotionals, I basically just saw myself reflected in the word. So I can read it for you guys. So it's Hosea 2, 13 through 15, and it starts off with, "She went after her lovers, but me she forgot, declares the Lord. Therefore, I am now going to allure her. I will lead her into the wilderness and speak tenderly to her. There I will give her back her vineyards and will make the valley of Achor a door of hope. There she will respond as in the days of her youth, as the day she came up out of Egypt."
Okay, now I'm going to stop right there. You said you read that in your devotions one
yeah,
morning.
Yeah, I read it in Streams in the Desert.
Okay.
From that devotional.
Okay, and I'll tell you what, that is not a scripture that would generally jump out at a lot of people.
I know.
But isn't this beautiful how when we position ourselves for God to speak to us, He speaks to us. Well, He always speaks to us. We receive it, and we mm-hmm. hear what He wants us to hear for our good and for His glory. So I'm so curious. Tell us more about what God did through that scripture for you in those moments.
Yes. So the history of that scripture is, I believe, is Israel is kind of turning her back on the Lord. The people are worshiping other gods. And so God is saying, like, I'm going to take her into this wilderness. I'm going to take her away from what she's comfortable with. I'm going to take her away from these things that she loves, that she thinks she loves, to be alone with me. And I think that was a summer that God definitely did those things. I was relying on a lot of different things for comfort and not God. And I think, while I don't think God causes bad things to happen, I think He uses those things for our good. So I think He was very much like, this is a time for you to reconnect with me. And the key words of that passage that I really love is wilderness and there. So God doesn't say that He's gonna like keep her where she's comfortable and heal her. He says, I'm going to take her into this wilderness, and there I will like replenish her vineyards. And so I think that is just so powerful, because I think we keep expecting God to be like, okay, once this like season ends, then I'll be happy. Or once this bad thing is over, that's when I'll be joyful. That's when I'll praise God. And we're always going, like, this is a broken world. We are always going to have a bad thing happen to us or something that hurts us. And that's a really sad thing to think of. But, like, God meets us in that wilderness and in those trials. And that's where we can be joyful. We don't have to wait till something good happens, because we know that at the end of our road, the greatest gift of all is waiting for us, no matter how hard this life is. And that can be really difficult to see when we're in the wilderness, because, I mean, He talks about taking her into a desert. Like, that's terrible. Like, you know, like, it's hot, there's no water, you're uncomfortable, like, you know, but that is where He meets us. And I think that is just such a powerful thing to remember. And so I definitely just, like, relied on that verse through that whole summer of just being like, okay, like, He's in the wilderness with me, even though I can't see Him, even though, like, I can't feel Him sometimes. He is in this wilderness. And that's something that I have had to hold on to ever since then, because I think sometimes it's very easy to fall into that trap of being like, my life is the worst, or, like, mm-hmm. I'll never get, this will never get better, mm-hmm. or, like, and it's so easy to fall into those things because it's really easy to be miserable. It's hard to be joyful, but we have to choose that joy.
I'm speechless at the wisdom out of such a young and beautiful lady. I wish I'd had that wisdom at your age, but boy,
yeah,
absolutely. Libby and I are just kind of jumping up and down saying, yes, yes, yes.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, and Ellie, I just have to reaffirm all that you're saying because it's good for you to hear it again, I know. But it's so good for us to hear it. It's so good for the listeners to hear it. Again, when we tell our story or our God moments out loud, and I love the way you referred to them earlier in the week as God winks.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness, I love that. God is always winking at us, you know, wanting us to pay attention to what he's doing right now, in this moment. And that's so sweet. And I think he winks with a smile. And I love the way you allowed his scripture from Hosea to speak to you right where you were in that mess. You opened yourself up to hearing from God in your mess from a scripture that could have just gone right over your head or right over anybody's head that reads it. But I love when you talked to us about God took her into the wilderness to create that healing. And bad things in a broken world, God allows them. Yeah, and I would say he causes them at some points. Sometime we don't know when, we don't know how, we don't know why, except for this, that God knows. He knows what it takes to bring each of us into relationship with him and to make each of us more as he is. And if we're willing to say to him, whatever it takes, Lord, I think that's the most dangerous prayer we could ever pray. And sometimes I had an easier time praying that when I was younger. And I find that the older I get, the harder it is for me to just say, whatever it takes, Lord, because I do think of what that could mean. And am I willing? Am I willing to lay down my Isaac, as you talked about? Yeah. Am I willing to give that up because God knows and understands something better for me? But the fact that you have taken us into this little scripture passage from Hosea and led us to such a beautiful place, and that that is what God wants to do for each one of us. And when I think of the way Israel had basically prostituted herself over and over in front of God, and that he uses this relationship of Gomer and Hosea to illustrate that. And I think I'm just not going to read this again the same as what I did before because of what you shared. And isn't that the beautiful part of doing this together?
It is. It really is. Because God's word is God's word. It hasn't changed. And yet now we can look at it through a different lens, maybe with a different understanding. That's how God's word works in our hearts and lives. Mm-hmm. I was really impressed that at such a young age, your focus already, Ellie, is not on the things that we struggle through here, but what lies ahead. And it did make me think of 2 Corinthians 4. And I'm just going to read those verses, starting with 16. Therefore, we do not lose heart, even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory, while we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. And that's what God is working in us for eternity, not for the temporal here on earth. And I loved how you put that he doesn't cause these problems, but he takes those difficulties that are going to come to us in a broken world, and he uses them for our good if we let him. And that's amazing. Amazing wisdom coming from one so young. So that's pretty exciting to hear.
I mean, sometimes I don't make the right decision. Some days I definitely choose to be miserable, and those days are not good days, you know? And so I have to remind myself that, like, you need to be joyful. You need to remember the other blessings in your life. Just because this one thing isn't happening doesn't mean like a good thing won't come. And I also just have to remind myself that I'm still young. Like I still love to think things are like the end of the world. Like I love to do that. I love to be like, this is the end of my, like, this is everything I've ever wanted, and it's crushed and it's obliterated.
But that is the drama and the creativity that God is putting, right?
Yes, yeah. Like,
part of it, right there.
And
awesome.
it's something I have to like check myself on every day and be like, this is not the end of the world. Like, calm down. Like, you have so much more time, hopefully, like, God willing. But, like, you know, like, you have a life to live that God has given you. And I just have to remind myself that every day I have to choose to be dramatic in happiness and not dramatic in, like, in sadness. So.
Well, and I love that we're talking about where our focus is at, because I think that is true. And God's words tells us whatever things are true, whatever things are lovely, whatever things, you know, we think on those things for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
Because if we dwell on the negative, it can take us down kind of a dark hole. And also it leads us to a path that maybe we'll be listening to lies instead of truth, because regardless of circumstance, we have many things to praise God for, and that's truth. But if you put your eyes on the circumstance, I think I mentioned this before. I've been reading a book by Paul David Tripp called Suffering, and in it he talks about looking at our circumstances and defining God by them, like, oh, God can't love me, or God, he, you know, what kind of God would allow this to happen? We're looking at the circumstances and defining who God is, rather than saying, God is our Father, and he wants the absolute best for us, and he will use this for his eternal glory. Defining our circumstances by who God is, by who we know he is to be, and we find that in his word. So,
yeah.
Amazing to come from one so young.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Well, and I am reminded of something I had shared, I don't know when, but I know it was on radio sometime, of a young man who, again, very wise, looking at the body of his dead father in the hospital who had just passed, and saying to his family standing around him, if we knew all that God knows, we would understand this. Mm-hmm. And I just think that is something I need to keep in the front of my head so often. And it goes back to something I said earlier. I don't want to understand everything about God. I don't want to know all the answers, because then it's like he would not be God to me. I'd be God. And boy, I don't want that. So I love, love, love the fact that we can lean into, Missy, as you said, who God is, and get the right perspective about our circumstances from him, instead of getting a perspective about God through our circumstances. That would be tragic. That would be tragic. Let's not do life that way. Well, it's time for a break. So let's take a break, and we'll be back soon here in the Circle of Friends.
Grab your car keys and round up your squad. It's the perfect time of year for a one-tank trip. Nestled among the rolling hills of Ohio's Amish country, Village Gift Barn, Country Gatherings, and the Gardens are must-see sister stores that are right next door to each other. We carry one-of-a-kind finds and pride ourselves on delivering good old-fashioned customer care for a wow experience. Customers often call our stores hidden gems. Stop by and find out why. Three destination stores, one convenient location, Village Gift Barn, Country Gatherings, and the Gardens at 4755 State Route 39 in Berlin, Ohio, in the heart of Ohio's Amish country.
Kiss the midnight sky, and I can't stop the tears from falling from my eyes. Though I'm all alone tonight, I can sense your presence, hear your lullaby. Your joy comes in the morning. Your favor, oh God, makes me secure. joy comes in the morning. Your mercies, O Lord, forever endure. I cling to promises you've made, a future and a hope, strength combined with grace. And as the wind touches the trees, your breeze, I can feel your love reach out to cradle me. Your joy comes in the morning. Your favor, O God, makes me secure. Your joy comes in the morning. Your mercies, O Lord, forever endure. Across a lifetime, there's only love. It never fails, it never fades or changes. The one thing I am sure of, your joy comes in the morning. Your favor, oh God, makes me secure. Your joy comes in the morning. Your mercies, O Lord, forever endure. Your joy comes in the morning. Your favor, O God, makes me secure. Your joy comes in the morning. Your mercies, O Lord, forever endure. In the morning, joy comes in the morning.
We're back here in the Circle of Friends. I'm Libby, and I'm here with Ellie and Missy. And Missy, before the break, you had mentioned, you'd referenced Philippians 4:8 about why it's so important to choose what we think about, mm-hmm. what we focus on. And I want to go ahead and read that. I know Philippians 4:8 is probably a very familiar passage to people. But I think it's one of those that I know I used to have it on the screensaver of my phone, and yet it's there. But do I really look at it and pay attention to it and live by it?
Yeah.
So I think it's good to just really remind ourselves of these things. But I'm going to start in verse 4 of Philippians 4, because Ellie, this reminds me of what you said about choosing joy. It is a choice, and it's right here. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. Now, I think that just kind of sums up a whole lot of what we've been talking about. And Ellie, it goes back to, when I read this, I think of your term, God winks. I think of how we talked about God is always at work, moment by moment. We just need to pay attention. And here it is, right here. The Lord is at hand, mm-hmm. right there. I just love this whole passage.
I do too, and I guess that's why I quote a part of it without giving the reference, but it's a familiar passage, obviously, but when you think about the things we've talked about this week in terms of our stories, mm-hmm. and we all have a story, But as Ellie, you said before the break, that we live in a broken world. We live in a fallen world. We are going to have difficulties come our way. And if they haven't yet, they will. So let's be prepared for it, because it's the world we live in. It's the reality of that. So really having the right focus, the right perspective. And honestly, if we could learn this lesson that you've talked about, Ellie, of rejoicing, of praising God, of thanking Him, of being grateful, our lives would be totally different. I mean, I can think of a number of brothers and sisters that I've met over the course of my life, people who do love God, but they've gotten stuck in disappointment, in heartache, in whatever, you know, whatever circumstance life brought their way, and they define God by those circumstances. Mm-hmm. And so bitterness is set in, and so they're stuck. They're really, of all people, most miserable, because they can't live a life that says there is no God, because they believe in God and they have a relationship with Him, but they've lost sight of who He really is.
They've defined God.
And mm-hmm. so therefore their trust in Him has been broken. And I mean, it's a miserable existence. Mm-hmm. It really truly is. Mm-hmm. So I love going back to the Word of God and readjusting our thinking, because the world, other people, our own ideas are going to pollute the truth if we're not careful. And yeah. remember, we have an enemy. And the first place he attacks is in our mind. Mm-hmm. He is the father of lies. I mean, he's going to spit lies at us left and right. And so earlier in the week, you talked about the song, The Voice of Truth. I mean, there it is, folks.
That's right.
What we have to listen to.
That's right. That's right. Well, and when you called the enemy the father of lies, which is what Scripture calls him, it just made me think. Think of someone in your life, or maybe not in your life, but you've heard about, who is a really great liar. I mean, and you're like, how do you live your life like this? You just lie. And they're so good at it. Well, Satan is that on steroids.
Yeah.
So, I mean, he's the father of lies, to the point where he lies so well you don't even recognize he's lying.
Yes.
He makes it sound like truth. And one of the ways that you do that is you put a little thread of truth in there.
Mm-hmm.
But just like all it takes is one drop of poison to pollute pure water, one little shred of truth will not make a lie true. It won't. It's still a lie. And so we need to be on our guard about that. You cannot clean up a lie by just putting a little bit of truth in there. You have to get rid of the lie completely.
Yeah.
You know, one of the other parts of this scripture passage that I read is right at the end, where Paul says, "What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you." And I just want to focus on that verse, because I don't think Paul is tooting his own horn. I don't think he's being arrogant at all. I think he's referencing when he said, "Follow me as I follow Christ." And you know what he's saying to us? This is important for all of you, to be in community with others who are like-minded, who are Christ followers, so that you learn from each other. You are iron sharpening iron. You learn from each other, and that is how the peace of God, the grace of God, the fullness of God, the fruit of the Spirit, that's how everything becomes alive and continues to grow. If we don't take that proactive approach, then we just leave the door open for the enemy to come in and have his way with us.
You know, I love how the Message puts these verses, going back to, I think this is verse 6, but don't fret or worry. Instead of worrying, pray. Let petitions and praises shape your worries into prayers, letting God know your concerns. Before you know it, a sense of God's wholeness, everything coming together for good, will come and settle you down. It's wonderful what happens when Christ displaces worry at the center of your life.
Mm-hmm.
That's a beautiful passage and almost illustrative in what we're talking about here, of how displacing the you know, those lies, getting them, putting the truth there, displacing mm-hmm. worry with trust, with prayers of praise, displacing anxiety or sadness or being fretful or any of those things with praise, with joy,
that's
being
right.
joyful. You have to replace it, I think, and that's true for all of us. Whether that's in your mind or your emotions, what you're focusing on, you can't leave that space empty or it'll fill up with something negative. You know what I'm mm-hmm. saying? You have to be intentional about putting something from God's word in that, his truth, his principles, making him your focus rather than something else.
So true. And I'm so glad you brought that up. It's not like, you know, like when you have an appendectomy, you get rid of the appendix. There's nothing there to take its place. But that's not the way it is with our thought life.
Yeah,
we do have to replace what we want to get rid of. We have to replace it. And I think of, I don't know where it is in Scripture, where we hear about, you know, the demon that's put out of this man. And he doesn't replace it with anything. And so the demon comes back and brings his friends.
Yeah.
And it's even stronger and worse. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, we have to replace the bad with the good, the unhealthy with the healthy, and not just think we can get rid of it. It has to be replaced.
Going back to kind of what you said earlier, Libby, about surrounding yourself with like-minded people, I think sometimes Christians choose to surround themselves with no one. And I think that can be just as detrimental as surrounding yourself with the wrong type of people. Because I think loneliness is something the enemy loves to prey on.
Yeah.
The enemy mm-hmm. loves to make us feel isolated. So while we are like, oh, like, I am alone, so I'm not, like, no one is, like, influencing me, we are still broken people in ourselves. And the enemy loves to say, like, you are alone because, like, no one loves you.
Yeah.
And I think that is almost worse or just as bad as surrounding yourself with the wrong type of people that'll make you do wrong decisions. Because loneliness is something that, like, it breeds a lot of different sins. Because our need to belong was something that God had put in us to go to him.
Mm-hmm.
But we always choose to go to other things. Mm. So we always have to be careful with that aspect of our lives.
So true. So
yeah.
true.
And while we need each other and God has given us one another, our need for God must be priority. And our dependency on him is priority. But we don't always see that either, because if we isolate ourselves and think we need no one, not even God, I mean, you know, we'll listen to the lies of Satan, or we'll be, you know, we'll look to friends first rather than to God first. So
yeah.
all of those things are going down the wrong road.
Yeah. And I think too, of course, God is our top priority. But one of the reasons, for a multitude of reasons, but one that comes to my mind right now is because when we go to him first, consult with him first, he is number one in our life, then he opens up our mind and our vision for who we do need to be hanging out with.
Mm.
And the like-minded Christ followers that teach us, that exhort us, that challenge us, that chastise us, that help us in our perspective, and those who are not Christ followers that we need to come alongside and be their friend and be that example to them, be that dear, unconditionally loving friend that can hopefully bring them to Jesus. And I don't want it to be like we're looking for projects. People are not projects. But God wants everyone to come to him, and he does that through us. And so we need to pay attention to who he's calling us to come alongside and be that for. Well, we're at the end of our day together, and it has been awesome once again. So good to be with you, Missy. So good to be with you, Ellie. Thank you for coming. And listeners, thank you for joining us. You found a place to belong here in the Circle of Friends.
Thanks to generous donations, this program is produced by Circle of Friends Ministries. You can write to us at P.O. Box 345, Berlin, Ohio 44610, or contact us at 330-852-0000. You've found a place to belong.